with a club or?
I was hoping people would read that sentence the other way.
This is really a hidden comedy show. That's what it's all about. Bob, do you have anything extra to talk about? Anything special that you've been up to lately? I know that the you're really big on the FDA administration.
Steve's been talking about that. That's really interesting to see where that's going to happen. Whether they're going to agree with the Federal Trade Commission, or Steve's prepared to be completely disappointed about how they're going to So you just cross your fingers, because if they decide to really do their job, that would be a wonderful thing. But the jury's still out on what they're going to do about that.
This is about homeopathy. The FDA finally said to homeopathy, you need to put non-scientific evidence. There's no scientific evidence about homeopathy on the bottles. And so we'll see.
You can't back it up with evidence and studies and experiments that you have to put on the bottle. That this is crap. So many words, but basically, like, there's no evidence to support this.
Like everyone else has.
Right, exactly.
That's scientific skepticism.
And this is putting our part in out of yours.
Are we okay volume wise in the back? Can everyone hear?
Yeah. What?
You can't just let us know. Brian, you're up, and then I'm going to just open it up to questions. I'll choose the people. My friends are first, so. Brian, anything else for you? We'll talk about Skeptoid?
Well, just not so much about Skeptoid. Just in terms of the theme of this evening, what is skepticism? What do I try to do with my show? And my favorite definition of what is scientific skepticism is the one that, as far as I know, it's attributed to Tim Farley of what's his website?
What's the harm?
Woo-hoo. Which is the intersection of science education and consumer protection. If people better can understand the way the world actually works, they're going to make better life decisions, whether it's what to buy, what to do for a living, where to go on vacation, just about anything. You're better off if you understand the difference between what's real and what's not. So that's kind of the guiding principle that I try to use when I decide what topics to go and how to cover them for my show.
And I did want to ask you before we go into Q&A, what is your definition of skepticism or scientific skepticism? Says Brian has already had his turn, so go ahead. What's your definition?
I was trying to come up with something different, because there's lots of great definitions out there. I came out with one that Daniel Loxton said, which was great. My brother, of course, came out with one. But I tried to throw
somebody.
Sorry.
Susan did it.
Wasn't me.
Okay. Now you are officially the light protector, Susan. I'm sorry about that.
So fine. So one good way to describe it that I came up with was it's an everyday methodology for dealing with empirical claims using science, critical thinking, and rational thought. It's so many different ways to approach it, describe it, but that does it justice a little bit.
Okay. Ross, what would you say?
I think it can be defined negatively, which it usually kind of gets cast as, and positively. So the negative definition would be that it's a default stance towards doubt when encountering any new claim. So we go in and say, there's a bar of evidence, you have to rise above that to prove what it is you believe. So the slowness to accept new conclusions. But more positively stated, it's, I think, a passion for truth. It's people who really get excited by knowing what's real and kind of this assumption that there is an underlying, like, objective truth. And then we establish that high bar of evidence to accept new truth. So.
Excellent. And I would add to that, that's what's more likely true, because everybody knows scientific skepticism is the last people to say what actually is true. We accept the truth, the knowledge and the evidence that we have temporarily until more or better evidence comes along and changes our mind. So we're never 100% sure. The level of confidence could be a whole other topic, I think. So first question.
Open all three of you. No. I will say this is not a direct answer to your question, but a question that I get a lot is similar, which is, are we making progress? Are we winning the battle, or are we losing the battle? And I think we're always going to be on the losing side of the battle. And the reason for that is that pseudoscientific products and beliefs, it's basically where the money is. that's always driving the economic engine. And we're never going to be able to compete with that.
We don't, yeah. We're not good with hope.
They are. You can't. How do you fight that?
The people who sell woo can say anything they want to say. We're limited to what we can support with evidence, which is all too often much more disappointing than we wish it was. You know, we can't be magically healthy. We can't all look like movie stars by buying something from the back of a magazine, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we're always going to be on the losing side, I think. But I look at that as a positive. It's an opportunity. It means we're never going to run out of work to do.
On a personal level, for me, I love seeing the emails that still come in to our group about people that, like for me, that they would say how I or maybe our group influenced people to become an astrophysicist. To me, when I get an email like that, like this person has entered a career in such a cool, you know, specialty like astrophysics or regular physics. It's just amazing that we can have some effect on people in that way. We still get emails from people that were at the far end of the woo spectrum. I mean, they were like hook, line, and sinker. They just bought it all. I don't know why they were listening to us if they were so far at that end of the spectrum, but they listened, and slowly over time we had an impact, and now they're like scientific skeptics. That's amazing when that happens. It doesn't happen very often, and when you are talking about skepticism, you don't really try to reach those people because they're just, you know, typically you're never going to get through to them. You want the people that are like on the fence and not sure where they want to go, or you want to preach to the choir and improve their critical thinking skills and teach them things. But sometimes you can still get somebody at the other end, and that's always.
I think you
wonderful.
Said something very important there, Bob, because people are not going to change their minds. Well, yeah, a lot of things, but the thing about having this one person change their minds, most people aren't going to change their minds. But it's those people that are curious enough to find out. Why are these people talking so much about this particular subject? And it could be homeopathy or woo-woo or psychic ability or anything. And just that curiosity, we're curious beyond compare, but if you have that sliver of curiosity, you have the ability to keep on listening to programs like your own.
Right.
And enjoy
being,
the book.
Right, and not being too proud to change your mind based on the evidence. You're gonna get stuck in your rut of your ideology, and nothing can impinge on that. Especially conspiracies are great for that, because anything you say for these grand conspiracists, they can just swat it away. Oh, you're just part of the conspiracy. There's no getting to that.
Well, then it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
Right. And if you could ask a question like, what would it take to change your mind? If they can't answer that question, then wow, that's not looking good for them. But you should always be able to answer that question. Someone says to you, Bob, I know we disagree on this, but what would it take for you to change your mind? You should have an answer. If you don't, you've got to think about it.
I'm going to tell a short story because it's a perfect thing of what you're going to be, or what you just said. I do quite a lot of debates in Orange County, and it's a particular type of Christian group that us atheists have debates on. And one time we had about 40 people, 20 on one side and 20 on the other. It was kind of like a marriage, you know, just naturally formed that way. And I asked the Christians, I said, well, if you thought of something that would be able to change your mind, just the thought of something that would change your mind, it's not going to happen, but just think of it, if it did happen, something like this, make something up, would you change your mind? And how many people here think that the Christians rose their hand? No. Then I turned to the skeptics, about 20 skeptics and atheists, and I said, if anything happened right now that you could think about that would change your mind, would you? How many skeptics rose their hands? I guess I didn't have to tell the story. It's absolutely true. And it was eye-opening to not the skeptics, but the Christians. It's like, everyone?
Right.
Everyone? That was the sliver of doubt that they might accept.
I don't think there's ever been a debate on the existence of God where either participant in the debate has afterwards been like, you know what? Those kinds of exchanges are purely for the listeners, and those are the ones who can hear the quality and the caliber of that conversation and be like, I don't like where this person's coming from. I don't like the arguments he's making. And then when they won't admit there's anything to prove them wrong, that says volumes to the others.
Funny you mention that, because I've had a discussion with Jay and Steve about, you know, what would it take for you to believe in God? You know, I'm an atheist, I'm sure a lot of us here are atheists. That's actually trickier than it sounds, because how would you know it's not just a super advanced alien and not a God, right? That would be kind of difficult. Really, to prove to me that that is God.
Magic is the same as
I'd still worship it.
Right?
So. I still worship it though.
I'd just be happy if they didn't kill us. I'd be their pet. You want me to be their pet?
That's the easiest question.
That's how I can feel about AI. It's like, you know, if they take over, like, I'd just be happy being a pet to an AI. But yeah, it's funny to think how, what would it really take?
I'll give you an example. What about if tomorrow we wake up and there's two moons in the sky?
Did someone pray for that?
Two moons in the sky. That's an example of something that would pique my curiosity and change my mind, because an advanced civilization could make a moon from the energy of the sun and be invisible.
I'd probably go to the optometrist if I got it.
That's one of my favorites.
Which is actually great skeptical comment. What you do is you go through that checklist of the mundane, silly things that you have to check off first before you jump to that bottom conclusion, that little check that says, and you know, an alien brought another moon into orbit around the Earth, because that's pretty damn unlikely. So you got it. And that's what people, that's what pseudoscientists do. They leap across all those other checks and they go to the bottom to the fun one, the one that makes, that's awesome, but scientists go through all the checks. You know, it's not that, but you got to go through it, otherwise you're short-circuiting the
And
process.
What about those check marks that we can't even think about?
Right, you got to consider that as well.
You were talking about that humility. Like, first you examine yourself. Like, what is my perception? How able am I to objectively even, you know, consider this? And so you run down all of those questions first, of your own ability.
I would say, can you see that too, or is it
just exactly. Some strength in numbers, okay, we're getting somewhere. Are there any gas leaks in the area? to answer Spencer's question a little more about kind of like the effect of what we do, I like to think, like I was saying earlier, that skepticism, at least, you know, people who are active skeptics, like what motivates them is this passion for knowing what's true. And I think there's a continuum, that's why my hands keep going back and forth, there's a continuum from like people who just really aren't motivated to know what's true, they're motivated by personal fitness or whatever else it is in their lives. And then over on this end is like everybody in this room, like we really care about what's true about the universe. And I think by producing the stuff that we do, I think putting that out there makes it easier for people a little farther down on that scale to have access to better information. And so it lowers the bar of entry to getting good information about the world.
Then what always puzzles me is there's people that they just don't give a shit. They like, they don't know what the moon is. There was some YouTube video, these announcers were talking and they were talking about the moon, and somebody was saying they literally did not know what the moon was, or that the Earth is in orbit around the sun. And to me, I don't know how reachable anybody is. If you don't care, just shocks me that you could be so overwhelmingly uninterested in something as basic as that. If you don't have the curiosity to figure out, to at least learn or absorb from culture that the Earth is in orbit around the sun, or that the moon, what the moon is, to me, I just can't relate to people like that. And I don't know what it would take to make them curious and love science the way we all do. It just shocks
me. I think that's one of the passions of everybody here in this room and anybody who joins the skeptic movement, is that we are more curious about the natural world and how it works. It's mind-boggling, just like what you said, especially if all these surveys come out about how many people know about the sun revolving around the Earth. And sorry.
That may explain why it is that Europe is so secular before the internet.
Why is Europe so secular before the internet?
Of the amount of religiosity in the country, excuse me, and the strength of the social network, and how secure people are in their welfare. And Europe, whether you like it or not, people are very, very secure. And the need for religion seems at some point to go along with this sort of suffering. So there's this existential angst, and that increases your religiosity.
People are
if you don't need to worry all the time where your next meal is going to come from, whether you're going to be homeless, whether or not you could possibly have a job, you're free to explore.
I think the only country that goes against that is us.
The most religious country of all of the industrialized countries.
Well, let me answer this point in your question directly. From my perspective, I don't think that you can take any one particular category of woo belief and use it as a metric for whether people, the population overall, has a more skeptical scientific thought process. Because you've got Christians who don't believe in Bigfoot, and you've got people who believe in Bigfoot who are atheists, and UFOs and everything else, and organics this, and detox diet that. When I've gone to, I've spoken in Europe a number of times, in former Eastern Europe, at one or two skeptic conferences, but also some software and security conferences, and I get challenged all the time on conspiracy theories. They may not be very religious, but they are the hardest core conspiracy theorists I've run across.
Right, I don't think that skepticism and atheism are necessarily the same thing. There are, so yes,
yeah, you've got
the vast majority of Europeans are secular, but are they skeptical?
Yeah, and when you're talking about the rising generation, I think you're talking more about a characteristic of Generation X and what's popular these days, more than you are, because those same kids
not becoming more skeptical.
Yeah, I don't necessarily see that.
You may see it more than I do.
Another question, anybody? This gentleman here has another question.
You know, what episode can I get that'll clue him in on that? I say, don't play him that episode. Don't play him the episode that directly challenges his sacred cow. Get him interested in these other ones that he's already skeptical about first. He'll decide, hey, I like the show. I like this guy. Maybe I'll listen to some more. You got to warm them up. You got to ease them into it. You got to introduce them to the right thought process so they're more willing to understand the reason why they should challenge the sacred cow.
Yeah, that's the approach you've taken on the SGU. We've always thought it was best to not directly confront people with their religious beliefs, because the shields go up. They just go up, and you're not going to get through. What we like to think is that if we teach you the skills of critical thinking and science and neuropsychological humility and all that stuff, then, you know, eventually, and that happened to me. I mean, I was never religious, but I believed in God. Never really went to church, but I mean, I was a believer, never much of one, but it was there. And so I started getting into skepticism, and I knew, UFOs were bullshit, ESP were baloney. But and eventually, I turned my gaze to, I was like, oh man, of course. I mean, come on, what took me so long? But it happened. And that happens a lot. And I think it's a good way to approach it. But if you want to be somebody who does confront it, and that's your focus, then good luck. Good luck and have at it, that's fine. But I personally don't think that's the most effective way to address it.
Before I come around to singing both of your tunes, I'll just take a moment to say, I think there's a role for people, well, I mean, Dawkins, I don't know if frontal assault is even the right word for him. I mean, he's a nice British man who doesn't really raise his voice, but uses big words, and very well. I think we need a variety of approaches, and I think we need people to do what comes naturally to them, and that's why there's like so much space for people to enter into the skeptical movement and kind of speak the way that they do. And I've met many people who have been influenced by Dawkins' books, myself included, and some who have been converted fully to that, but for other people that's totally not the right approach. So I think we need a bit of everything,
right.
and then you can
absolutely
point your friends to what you think will work for them. But to what you guys were saying, I think people need to own their discoveries.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't hand anybody their conclusions. And so if the way you're interacting with someone is telling them you're wrong, and the conversation you're hoping will end with them admitting they were wrong, stop what you're doing. You're doing it wrong.
That's confirmation bias.
Yeah, exactly. You're kickstarting that human process to defend your sense of self, your sense of intelligence, cognitive bias, cognitive dissonance. That's exactly what it is. And so instead, it sounds manipulative, but you need to find a way to kind of let them feel that they're coming up with the ideas,
mm-hmm.
or do that Socratic
mm-hmm.
method where you help them build up to the conclusion, and then they have ownership of it, like, oh, you know what I realized? And that's why books are cool, because you're putting yourself in someone else's head, and you own whatever, you know, you're reading there, and that's why it's hard to frontal assault with a book.
So before this next
Yeah, more loudness, though. I don't know if that's the...
But it works, unfortunately, it works. When we all started doing our podcasts, you know, 10 years ago, we were hoping it was going to lead on to bigger and better things, and here we still are doing our podcast. Right? It's because we haven't cracked the formula of how you make this a commercially successful message that's going to get on primetime television.
Right.
If you've got any great ideas, let me know. Yeah,
I think it's the aggregate, because look at how many atheist programs are on podcasts now. I mean, it just exploded, you know, 5 to 10 years ago. Look how many skeptical programs are on now. Emery isn't here. There's Skeptically Yours. No Emery here? Okay, he'll be here later on. He helped with the comedy show coming tomorrow night, by the way. Big plug. So,
it's a long, hard battle, but you just got to keep plugging away at it the best way you can. You know, we can only control what we personally can do.
Sure.
And so just have to keep doing it the best you can.
You know, hopefully it's great. See, you guys do a great job of whittling away at that confidence, confidence of ignorance. And you whittle it away, but then you have a large swath of people who say, well, now I don't know, and they're less likely to speak up. So we have, like in everything else, religion, whatever you want, politics, science, you have the crazies who are the loudest because they are so damn confident and they want to be more right than you or him or the next guy. They want to be more right. They don't have to be. They're not right, but they want to be more right. And so, I mean, at what point do you go, you're the stupid, you know, because you're not going to crack that egg.
Yeah.
You're not going to convince them of anything. And I think by letting them off the hook, by, well, I give up, I can't talk to you, they're not being punished for their stupidity.
That's a fair point. I was going to say, what's the effect? But in aggregate, that can marginalize someone and make them at least feel uncomfortable saying the things that they're saying. So that can have an effect. But as you were talking, it was reminding me of just kind of like evolutionary timescales and how, you know, like evolution can only act on an individual, essentially. And you have to wait for, you know, successive generations for these little tiny changes to make effect. And in some ways, I mean, there is like horizontal transmission, but in many ways, we just need to wait for certain people to die off.
I don't think it's going to work,
but new ideas take time to propagate.
Darwin absolutely said that.
I suppose the my biggest concern now that I have children.
I only see one.
Yeah.
So, skeptical of your point.
Not the other one.
Is, are the Looney Tunes going to burn the place down before we get everyone else to pull their heads out?
No.
I am not as confident.
Next
question. Okay, another question. Anybody?
Yes. Bill Silver. That is the downside of it.
Have you done that for your show?
I haven't yet.
Sorry, oil?
Colloidal silver. It's
turned you blue.
Yeah, you're putting silver in your body way past your normal healthy balance and you turn blue.
But it keeps the werewolves away.
That is the other thing. So I guess that's a way of saying, yeah, you're right. It also creates a haven and a platform for the crazy. Well, anyone can make a blog. And so it becomes a true marketplace of ideas. Still, I think we're doing okay in that marketplace.
I find it to be a zero-sum game. I mean, we get our information out more efficiently, they get theirs more efficiently.
I think they get it a little bit more efficiently. It seems that way.
We've got Snopes, though.
Yeah, I do. But when you do Google searches and you just see what comes up.
Well, do you guys get joy out of... obviously, you're not going to reach the majority of the people in the United States or the world for that matter, but do you enjoy getting to these particular people that are really going to get a kick out of what you've researched on your shows?
Well, sure.
You get enjoyment from it, right?
Absolutely.
We're all self-serving then.
There's a way you could spell any altruistic act in
that's
terms
self-serving,
of what
that's
it
correct.
Does
we cannot
you
have an altruistic act.
In that sense, I'll concede the point.
All right, no philosophy class here, just questions. Any more questions?
We do audio all the time, and it's difficult, but it's doable. We try audio and video. It's like holy crap. We've done live streaming a few times. That is so difficult. Even if you've got experts. I mean, think about the conferences that we go to where with audiovisual cracks out every time.
Every time you try to do something.
It's valuable. You can reach a lot of people, and video is great, but it's people don't appreciate it. But how much harder it is than just pure audio.
It is being done, though. There's a lot
it's
of great
done. It is,
out
but
Captain Dissolution.
Oh, he's
put so
my
much
God.
Work into those
this
episodes.
It's
and
crazy.
The result is he's only able to put one out every 2 or 3 months.
Sure.
Right.
Your search for confirmation bias.
Right. Yeah. Totally.
Your search for confirmation bias on the internet and on YouTube. You know, there's a lot of them.
Yeah. I've agreed with that idea for a long time, and the YouTube audience is much bigger than the podcast audience. And so I've got two short video series that are on YouTube, and since they take a hell of a lot of work and time put together a 3-minute episode, I have each one has to be individually crowdfunded, and it takes 4 or 5 months to fill one.
It's worthwhile. I would recommend Dark Matter 2525 as well. It's not comedic, it's a cartoon type character. It's very, it's a little on the harsh side sometimes, but check it out, Dark Matter 2525. Has anybody known about that, Dark Matter 2525?
Yeah, he's very satirical. And at the same time making a point. Probably one of the best ones ever, if you get a chance, is What God Can't Do. And he talks about the free will or lack thereof.
Oh, free will, yeah. Do we really want to go there?
Yeah. But it's very clever. And like you said, it's somewhat harsh.
That's right.
Mr.
Well,
Deedy.
This is not a philosophical conference. Oh, we do talk
about it. Skeptically called.
Okay, last chance, sir. You got three chances. You got three. This is the fourth one.
I know. I have a lot of questions.
I like to talk too. So I hear you. Go ahead.
You know, the idea came up with how do you talk to somebody who doesn't have any curiosity? I want to know, how do you talk to somebody who doesn't value evidence? I can think of somebody
that's frustrating.
Shortly will put his hand on a book he hasn't read. To swear an oath he's not going to keep, to defend the Constitution he doesn't understand. He doesn't value evidence. And how do you talk to somebody like that?
It's difficult.
You compliment
him. I've encountered that a lot with people having political discussions in the past 6 months. It's scary. It's like any source you cite, oh, they're full of shit. Whatever you say, their sources are great. My sources are all fake news, apparently. I
just heard a great podcast episode about that, dealing with that exact question. And I'm sitting here, I'm trying to remember the name of the podcast, and I can't, but I'm trying to remember the name of the guy who was on it.
What the content?
He was an economist, and he and his partner, if anyone knows what I'm talking about, please shout it out. He and his partner were talking about the different, how to persuade someone who has a whole different set of moral values than you do. And the obvious example is Democrats versus Republicans in here. How does a Democrat convince a Republican about global warming? How does a Republican convince Democrats that organic bullshit, whatever it is. And this is a fascinating, fascinating episode because they really have cracked the nut of how you go about doing that. You just have to figure out what their underlying moral value system is, and then you make your argument completely in those terms. So if you were to look at the argument that a liberal should put together to persuade a conservative about global warming, for example, it's going to look really silly to most liberals. It's going to be about global warming is a patriotism issue. It's all about, you know, we can control the other nations if we do more about global warming than they do. It's that kind of thing. And forgive me, I know I'm offending someone. I'm just kind of making this up as I go. So it's that kind of an idea.
Does anyone know
Robert
Reich?
I'm talking about?
Was it Robert Reich?
No, I've heard of it.
I don't think so.
A little guy.
I can find it.
First of all, you cannot offend anybody. They have to choose to be offended.
No, thank you. I'll find what that was because I talked about it recently. I've got it written down, and I'll put it on my Twitter feed. If someone wants to look at my Twitter, you'll find what it was. It's Brian Dunning on Twitter.
But you could say, like, if you really care about abortion, you'll see there are fewer abortions when there's more sex education.
Yeah.
It's that same sort of argument where you can
latch
on to what they really care about.
One of the concerns, I'm afraid, like you said, people don't value evidence. They don't know what evidence is.
Right.
They don't know what a fact is.
Well,
I can't tell
you
how they
don't know how to extinguish woo-woo. They don't know how to extinguish
distinguish
from from pseudoscience because they don't know how to interpret the science, even because everybody's saying different things, like closing things. So.
Right.
Which brings us back to scientific skepticism, which hopefully teaches you how to evaluate evidence and understand what's good evidence, what's bad evidence. So.
One of the things that I want to ask you, Bob, is that do you ever get a case where somebody's presenting a particular claim and they believe this claim is true? Do you argue not necessarily the evidence from the claim that they're making, but if the claim were true, what else would have to be true after that to follow it up? Conspiracy theorists is one example.
Absolutely. I think that's
tell me how you do that, or how that works.
Well, I mean, I can't judge
the government was behind 9/11, talk me out of it.
Yeah, I can't judge a specific example, but that's a powerful method to see that, all right, if I believe this, then A, B, and C would necessarily have to follow from that. That would be a ramifications. And I think, I wish I had a good example, but that is powerful, and I think it's very useful to do if you don't have, like, here's this dot, you know, here's these evidence, here's this report, this study, but you say, well, let's follow that to its logical conclusion. And not a slippery slope thing, but something that's reasonable that you would anticipate to happen.
Well,
they were correct.
Sure. One of the arguments that I use that I think is a very simple idea is that if this X religion was true and their God was the only one that was going to heal other people, you would walk into any hospital with a condition and you would say, I'm with this X religion.
Right.
And the nurse would say, well, you get out of here in 20% less than anybody else. In fact, you get everybody that believes in your X religion around the entire world gets out of the hospital 20% faster than everyone else.
Right.
That would follow something.
Sure. Or why haven't psychics won the lotto or made billions of dollars? And but the problem is with that is that they will come up with some bullshit excuse why. Oh, that's not right. They wouldn't, you don't use those powers for earning money. So they will always have an answer. But hopefully some people think about it.
This guy can't keep back his laughter over here.